let's look at differentiating the inverse trig functions. So y equals the inverse sine of x. How am I going to find out this one's derivative? Well, we already know how to differentiate just the regular sine of x. So if I rewrite this and make x the subject, then x becomes sine y. So instead of finding dy dx, I'll find dx dy. Therefore, my derivative is 1 over the cosine of y. Now, that is the derivative. It's just in terms of y. That's fine, I suppose, but it's probably going to be more convenient to be in terms of x. So how on earth do I transform this back into x? And it's via trig identities. Cosine of y I could rewrite as the square root of the cosine squared. Cosine squared I can write as 1 minus sine squared. But hang on, we said sine was x, so now we can get x back in there, and we get 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared. Inverse cos, we can do a similar thing. So we make x the subject, differentiate that one, it becomes minus sine. So now, how do I get the x back in there? Pretty much the same technique. We'll square root the square. Sine squared becomes 1 minus cos squared. And again, we get 1 minus cos squared. Now, they're very similar. And that makes sense because the sine curve and the cosine curve are also very similar functions. Inverse tan. Okay, make x the subject. Differentiate tan, we get sec squared. 1 over sec squared. Well, this one's a lot easier to get the x back in because it's already squared. And sec squared, we know, is 1 plus tan squared. So we get 1 on 1 plus x squared. So there's the three basic derivatives. But let's generalize these. If it's a linear function, you might find it easier just to go, oh, well, if it's x over a, then it's 1 over the square root of a squared minus x squared. Inverse cos, well, it's the same, but it's negative 1 over the square root of a squared minus x squared. Inverse tan, got to be careful with this one because it's a over a squared plus x squared. Very easy to make a mistake with that because the other two have 1 on the top. That's why, personally, I prefer to think of it in its totally generalized form where it's just a function. Because if I differentiate inverse sine of function x, I get the derivative over the square root of 1 minus the function squared. Inverse cos x will be minus the derivative over the square root of 1 minus the function squared. And inverse tan is the derivative over 1 plus the function x squared. So in each one, it's still the derivative on top. Let's look at some examples then. So if we have inverse sine of 5x, okay, I could do it the quick way with the x over a, or I could think of it like this. I could go, well, it's just the derivative. Derivative of 5x is 5 over the square root of 1 minus the function squared. Well, 5x is 25x squared. I get it in one line. If I had done it the other way, a is 1/5. So we'd end up with 1 over the square root of 1/25 minus x squared. Then you got a fraction on a fraction. So you end up multiplying to get rid of the fraction, and eventually you'll get there. But as I say, using the second one, I can get it in one line very quickly. So the advantage now is I don't have to worry about linear functions, though. If I use the second one, I can still handle this quite easily because it's going to be the minus the derivative in this case. So minus e to the power of x over the square root of 1 minus the function squared, so e to the 2x. Again, bang, I can do it in one line. I will concede the first formula, when you actually have x over a number, all right, that's when the first one has its advantage. All right, because then you go, oh, well, it's 1 on the square root of a squared minus x squared. Right, because had I used the other one, it would still work. I'd go, oh, derivative over the square root of 1 minus x squared on 9. Now I've got that problem of, oh, fraction on fraction. But that's okay. We can multiply everything by 3, top and bottom by 3, and we get the same answer. So yes, when we do have just that very simple function of x over a, that first one, I mean, is going to be an easier way of doing it. Oh, e to the power of inverse cos x. So it's now an exponential function that we're differentiating. So we said differentiate exponential, differentiate the power, put it in the front, e to the, and the power does not change. So the power in this case is inverse cos x. Differentiate inverse cos x, we get minus 1 on the square root of 1 minus x squared, but that now will be times e to the inverse cos x. I think it looks a bit neater with that on the top of the fraction. Doesn't really matter, I suppose. Anarchy. Bring down the power. 3, lower the power. 2, times diff the inside. Inside is inverse tan x, and the derivative of that is 1 on 1 plus x squared. Again, let's just make that look a bit neater. And remember, when we're dealing with inverse trig, we don't write that top as tan to the negative 2x. The negative 1 is not an index, okay? That's why we have the reciprocal ratios. Because if I want 1 over tan x, I say cotan x. Okay, product rule. Write down the first, x squared. Diff the second. The second is an inverse tan function, so I'll go derivative, 3x squared, over 1 plus the function squared, x to the power of 6, plus, write down the second, inverse tan x cubed. Diff the first, 2x. Let's tidy everything up. Oh, I suppose I could factorize an x out of that, but nah, I'll leave it like that one. Okay, let's look at some HSC questions that have been interesting and have involved inverse functions, but also calculus as well. So 2018 we'll start with. So function x is inverse sine x plus inverse cos x. That's our function. And the first one simply said, we'll show that derivative is zero. Well, differentiate inverse sine x, I get 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared. Differentiate inverse cos x, I get minus 1 on the square root of 1 minus x squared. So yes, that does equal zero. Hence or otherwise, prove inverse sine plus inverse cos is pi and 2. And this is what you have to think about. Well, hang on, what does this mean? The derivative is always equal to zero. Well, the derivative measures the slope of the curve. So this is saying it doesn't matter what x we put in. The slope of the curve is going to be zero. Therefore, the original function must have been a horizontal line. So we just need to prove that the equation of that, I guess, is y equals pi on 2. Okay. So, again, justify what you're doing and why you're approaching it in this way. So I said, well, since the derivative is zero, and I suppose the key is that inverse sine and inverse cos are both continuous functions as well. So that's important. Then function x would be a constant, because if one of those didn't exist for an x value, well, then you wouldn't get a consistent pi on 2. All right, all I've got to do is sub in a value then to work out what this constant is. Because if it's true for any value of x, so I've picked an easy one, zero. Inverse sine of zero is zero. Inverse cos of zero is pi on 2. There we get our pi on 2. So therefore, etc. Hence, go and sketch the curve. Sorry, there was another part to it. Sketch the curve because it's not the complete line. Remember, inverse sine and inverse cos have restrictions on the domain. They're only defined between minus 1 and 1. So therefore, my straight line only goes between minus 1 and 1. Okay, well, let's do a similar question then. Now my function is going to be inverse tan x plus inverse tan of 1 on x. Again, it starts off the same, show that the derivative is equal to 0. Well, it's a little bit more involved, this one. Differentiate inverse tan x, 1 on 1 plus x squared. Differentiate inverse tan, all right, derivative, minus 1 on x squared, over 1 plus the function squared, so 1 plus 1 on x squared, multiply top and bottom of that fraction by x squared, and we get minus 1 on x squared plus 1, so now they add together to give 0. Okay, there's the first part. Let it jump to sketch it. The thing about inverse tan of 1 on x, that one's going to be discontinuous at x equals 0. Other than that, it's going to be defined for all real x, because inverse tan is defined for everything. But the 1 on x is going to cause me a problem. Well, let's sub in a value. I can't use 0 because it's not continuous at that point. So when x equals 1, surprise, surprise, oh, there we go, we get pi on 2 again. But you see, if you've got a discontinuity, you have to check either side of the discontinuity, because when you sub in negative 1, look what happens. You actually get minus pi on 2. So yes, it's a constant value, but it's a different constant value for the negatives than it is the positives. So when we sketch this one, on the right-hand side, we've got the horizontal line at pi on 2, but on the left-hand side, it'll be at negative pi on 2, and point discontinuities on the actual axis itself. And then last year, still on the same theme, they had this one. So this time function x was the tan of the inverse cos of x, and g of x was the square root of 1 minus x squared on x. They've given us the graph of the second one just to be nice to us. Show that the derivative of both these functions are the same. All right? Well, function x, It's a tan function. Differentiate tan, I put the derivative of the angle. The angle is inverse cos x. Differentiate the angle, we get minus 1 on the square root of 1 minus x squared. Tan becomes sec squared, and the angle does not change. Remember, we're trying to show these two things are equal. Not really close at this stage. Oh, we've got square root of 1 minus x squared in both. Well, the reciprocal of sec is cosine. So on the bottom, I've now put cos squared, the inverse cos of x. Hang on. Cos of the inverse cos of x is x. So that becomes minus 1 over x squared root 1 minus x squared. This is looking more promising now. I might just start working on the other one. Let's see what happens. So g of x, quotient rule. Square the bottom, right down the bottom, diff the top. Minus, right down the top, diff the bottom. Let's send that square root to the bottom of the fraction, which means the first term becomes minus x squared. The second term becomes minus all of 1 minus x squared, so minus 1 plus x squared. X squareds cancel, and we get the same thing. So their derivatives are the same. And that's what we were trying to show. Using part one, or otherwise, show that actually these functions are the same. We know their derivatives are the same, but now we want to show the actual functions are the same as well. I'm going to move everything to the left-hand side. So a similar technique to what we used for inequalities, but I'm actually using it for inequality here. Because if I know these derivatives equals zero, therefore the integral of that left-hand side must be a constant. So the same idea there. So the integral of f dash x minus g dash x is equal to a constant number. So function g minus gx is a constant because the integral of the derivative must be the function itself. Now I can move g of x over to the other side. So yes, function x and g of x are the same, except of some vertical shift. So what I now need to show is that vertical shift is zero. And if it's zero, we're fine. So let's sub in a value. But thanks to the graph they've supplied me, I can see there is a discontinuity at x equals zero. So I need to test both sides of the discontinuity. So when x is greater than zero, I'll pick one. And I get the constant equal to zero. So good, that's what we wanted. But let's make sure it works for the other side as well. X is less than zero, I'll pick negative one. And yes, we end up with zero. On the left-hand side, we get tan of pi, but tan of pi is also equal to zero, so that's fine. So yes, we can show. And I would imagine that a lot of people wouldn't have tested both sides. They might have tested one side, and because it came up zero, they went, oh, great, it worked. So 12a.